Hello there, I'm Barry Mitchell, and welcome once again to Simply Science. Well, it's March, and that means it's been a year since the pandemic turned our lives upside down. Many of us miss the things we used to take for granted: going to work, going for a haircut, going to a restaurant, hanging out with friends. How has isolation affected our hunger to connect with others? Here's Mike Gilliam.
I miss running into people spontaneously. I miss seeing people in the hallway or in the office and just having a little chit chat.
It was very sad in the beginning because I'm not the type of person where I'm home all the time. I like to go outside. I like to experience things, especially in the heart of New York City.
I just miss being able to see my friends and not have to worry about hugging them or getting close to them.
Everyone's affected by the pandemic in one way or another. Now researchers have found that isolation has caused people to crave human contact, just like hungry people crave food.
What we found was that people who have been isolated, they showed very similar responses in a certain brain region, like people who have been fasted.
Dr. Olivia Tomova conducted a study of 40 people when she was at MIT. She's now at Cambridge and talked to us via Zoom from her home in Vienna. Tomova says to measure food cravings, subjects would fast and be scanned after being shown pictures of pizza and cake. They also isolated people for 10 hours before showing them pictures of people interacting.
So it wasn't that extreme what we did, but still we saw that a lot of people responded really strongly to that.
The study began long before the pandemic, but it's even more important now that people are working from home.
It indicates how sensitive our brain is to the experience of not having enough social contact, like how soon we already seem to see like changes in our brain responses.
Which brings us to one of the key ways we're connecting during the pandemic: social media, which can be good, but not always.
The pandemic has increased my use of social media quite extensively, and I notice how my well-being is going down when I use Instagram a lot.
Tomova offers some advice.
So if we interact through social media in an active way where we actually chat with someone and there's a back and forth, that seems to be helpful and that seems to increase well-being. While if we use it in a passive way, so just looking at pictures of others but not actually interacting with anyone, that seems to actually decrease well-being. This passive usage of social media kind of seems to do something that actually makes people feel more disconnected and lonely rather than the other way around.
So what we're doing right here, back and forth on a Zoom call, is that a good thing during the pandemic?
I mean, I would say so, yeah. It seems to come really close to the real experience of social interactions, right? There's, we have like communication, there is sharing of content.
What is it that we learned from that study that you did that might help us to understand what's going on mentally and psychologically during the pandemic?
So I think one sort of general takeaway of our study is that it sort of highlights how important being connected with others is for humans. So if already one day of being alone makes our brains respond as if we have been fasted for the whole day, it sort of suggests that our brain is very sensitive to the experience of being alone. So in times of social distancing, we might have to pay special attention to people's well-being and their mental health if they have to spend time in isolation.
So with isolation, the hunger to connect grows stronger every day, prompting most of us to dream of people getting together again when things return to normal. I'm Mike Gilliam for Simply Science.
March is Multiple Sclerosis Awareness Month. It's a disease that affects more than 2.3 million people worldwide, yet its causes remain a mystery. Our Ari Goldberg spoke with CUNY's Dr. Patricia Casaccia about ongoing research to help us understand MS.
Patrizia Casaccia has been deeply involved in neuroscience for decades. As the founding director of the Neuroscience Initiative at CUNY's Advanced Science Research Center, her fingerprints can be found across an impressive amount of research, specifically multiple sclerosis, MS.
Just to get a basic grounding here, what is multiple sclerosis? What do those words even mean?
Multiple means many. Sclerosis means hardening. So many hardenings. So normally immune cells do not see the brain. However, in multiple sclerosis, what happens is that there is a breach in this barrier so that the immune cells from the blood can enter in the brain. And in the case of multiple sclerosis, this hardening occurs because the immune system starts literally chewing on myelin, which is the protective coating of the nerve.
For most people, the blood-brain barrier keeps harmful things in the blood from passing into the brain. But for people with MS, the immune system sometimes gets through this barrier and can accidentally attack the brain cells, the neurons.
And the easiest thing to envision this is envision each neuron as a wire. And if the wire is has an insulation, the conductance of this electricity can go much faster. And so in multiple sclerosis, there is an attack of this insulating sheet.
And when that happens, the neurons don't operate as well. And this can lead to episodes ranging from vision problems to muscle weakness to cognitive problems, lasting for days or weeks until the sheath recovers.
You said how MS attacks the brain. Can you elaborate on the specifics of that?
Envision a wound. You know, let's say that you have a problem with your hand. And then eventually, if the cut is big enough, you're going to form a scar. The same kind of processes are occurring in the brain. You have an active plaque, and at the resolution of the plaque, you are left with a sclerotic mark, with a little scar.
For most people with MS, these episodes will come and go. For a long time, the nature of these episodes led to MS being viewed as primarily an immune disease with a genetic susceptibility. But according to Casaccia, her research has shown that's not the whole story.
We have trillions of bugs in the intestine. We always talk about the microbiome. There can be different types of bugs that create certain metabolites. So what we are noticing is that there are specific populations of bacteria that produce those metabolites that if they reach the neurons, they can damage them.
Casaccia's work has been vital in understanding these substances, how the molecular products of these gut bacteria, these metabolites, and also toxic lipids, that is to say toxic fats, can damage the brain too, not just the immune system.
So it's not seen as it's only environmental or it's only genetic, but you have to have the intersection of the two in order to have the disease start.
Such contributions, that MS can be looked at through a lens of both nature and nurture, has led to novel approaches in MS management, beyond a strict focus on the immune system, that eating healthier can blunt the buildup of these toxic substances.
This is why we also have created this task force with different members of the Multiple Sclerosis Society and different doctors throughout the world to try to come up with dietary guidelines for patients.
And as the scientific community advances in their research, hopefully, so does the outlook for MS patients. For Simply Science, I'm Ari Goldberg.
Next, our Elena Romero looks at what it's like living with MS and talks to a recently diagnosed patient and talks with some doctors about the available treatments.
Nearly 1 million people are living with multiple sclerosis in the U.S., and about 200 new cases are diagnosed here each week. Dr. Karen Blitz, the director of the MS program at the New York Presbyterian Brooklyn Methodist Hospital, explains who's at risk.
There is no genetic cause for this disease, and that's very important. So who gets this disease is probably a mixture of genetic and environmental factors, meaning some genomes, some genetic makeups are more likely to get MS, but there almost needs to be some environmental turn on that, like people with low vitamin D get MS more often. There's a question about whether or not certain viruses can set this disease off.
What exactly is multiple sclerosis?
So the best as we understand it right now, we think it's an autoimmune disease where the immune system is misguided or confused, and instead of acting only against viruses and bacteria, it's now acting against the central nervous system, specifically the brain and the spinal cord.
Most people with MS are diagnosed between the ages of 20 and 50, and it affects women three times more than men. 43-year-old Natalie Lozada was diagnosed 3 years ago after being in a car accident that triggered her symptoms.
I was officially diagnosed in June of 2017, but quite possibly I would had MS a lot longer. It was just going undetected.
Early signs and symptoms vary from patient to patient. The three most common symptoms are loss of vision in one eye, numbness, and weakness.
Pain started to hit pretty quickly. Within a couple of days and even weeks, numbness started to spread on my arms and my legs. So I went through physical therapy and we were trying to get to the bottom of it. Literally after I got the CAT scan, I was diagnosed with MS.
Other people come in with tremors or difficulty walking. They feel off balance. But in addition to those kinds of symptoms, some patients with MS even have cognitive changes. They have difficulty with their memory. Some symptoms like fatigue and pain are very treatable.
Some days I wake up and I feel fine and I'm ready to take on any normal responsibilities just like anyone else. But then there are other days where I don't feel so well, where I'm more tired than I should be.
Dr. Vanessa Maureen Collazo specializes in treating MS at the Mayo Clinic's Florida campus in Jacksonville.
Nowadays, we have many options of disease-modifying therapies that have been approved by the FDA. We have medications that are given as an injectables under the skin, we have oral medication, and we have infusion that can alter the disease course. They can lower the risk of further relapses, further MRI activity, and slow down disability accumulation.
Doctors say exercise, healthy living, and lifestyles are key to MS management and managing symptoms. While MS is a lifelong condition and has no cure, with the right care and support, many people can lead long, active, and healthy lives.
If we can manage their symptoms, they have great quality of life. If we can slow the progression of this disease, they can have great quality of life. But it's not just treatment, like disease-modifying therapy. It's not just emotional support. It's really a focus on wellness.
For Simply Science, I'm Elena Romero.
CUNY researchers are constantly finding out amazing things about our world. Recently, two Baruch professors discovered a mysterious sea creature that makes its own light. But what it spends every month in batteries, pfft. Here's Andrew Falzone.
Across our planet, 71% of the surface is covered in water, which means the most common landscape is actually seascape. According to NOAA, we've made some progress since the National Aquarium first posted this infographic in 2014, but still, some scientists think that more than 90% of ocean species have yet to be discovered, meaning there's 211 billion gallons of mystery still to explore. And sometimes that can lead to encounters, close encounters like this one.
What is it?
I don't know. You don't even know what the hell it is.
What looks like Mother Nature's version of a gelatinous slinky leaves those who encounter it mystified by what they found.
You never seen that?
Oh, that's a jellyfish. That's a kind of jellyfish.
We didn't know what it was either, but we found some people who do. Meet Dr. Chris Dadobe, Harvard PhD in genetics, and Dr. Gene Gaffney, Yale PhD in chemistry. Both assistant professors at CUNY and newly minted experts in these slimy creatures. And by the way, guys, it's not a jellyfish, but good guess.
Well, they look a lot like jellyfish. They look like they're filled with a jelly mass inside, but they're actually much more sophisticated than that.
A pyrosome is a sea creature, and they come in varying sizes, but the ones that we work on are about the size of your pointer finger. And they're very crazy. They look like corn cobs, like hollowed out corn cobs. And each pyrosome is basically one corn kernel.
Doctors Dobie and Gaffney became experts in pyrosomes after co-authoring a research paper with other scientists, including Dr. David Gruber of Baruch. And while the paper's title may be complicated, the takeaway is not.
The reason that the ones we're working on are super cool is because they glow in the dark. So they are able to produce their own light. And our question was, how? And, you know, how do they do this? And that's the question that we answered in the paper.
Sailors on big old wooden ships would see these glowing lights in the ocean. And so that's sort of amazing that people have been seeing these for a really long time. And it was only due to Jean's work that we were able to understand that where that light was coming from.
Before their research, scientists didn't know if pyrosomes made their own light or if there was another organism like bacteria living on the pyrosome that was responsible. But now we know.
So we were able to extract the RNA from the pyrosome itself. And so what we did was we took those genes, we made the proteins, and we tested them to make to see if they made light. And we were very surprised that they did. That's how we were able to figure out this bioluminescent protein.
Pyrosomes have a light organ. They have a siphon. It's just an opening. It's basically their water intake. And the light organ lies directly underneath that. And so if you look at some of the videos that have been taken, you can see a small little circle in each individual pyrosome that lights up. So it's not the whole organism that luminesces. It's a small circular point.
What is it that they are most directly related to that maybe people can relate to that they've seen before?
They're most closely related to other tunicates, which you would have seen kind of if you scuba dive, kind of attached to rocks.
So unlike their close cousins that anchor themselves to rocks, pyrosomes prefer to free float. But if they're relatively small, how come they look so big? Those long tubes are really free-floating colonies of many individual pyrosomes joined together, which means a pyrosome colony, in theory, could live forever, unless it becomes lunch for another sea creature, no matter how small or how big. I'm Andrew Falzone for Simply Science.
Did you know there are over 7 million species of insects? Most of them in my kitchen. But like them or not, they're disappearing from the earth in alarming numbers. Why?
Bugs. Who needs them? When they're not infesting your home, they find other ways to get you.
If I give kids a bunch of microscopes, I can bring a lot of them over to the side of appreciating insects and getting them away from this model that the only good bug is a dead bug.
Dr. David Wagner is an entomologist at the University of Connecticut, a booster of bugs.
Just about anything that's found on land or in fresh water and crawls or creeps.
And lately, their census taker.
Insects are declining. The little things that run the world are having a tough time.
Dr. Wagner is the lead author of a recent group of studies that indicate the Earth's insect population is decreasing by 1 to 2% a year.
1 to 2% doesn't sound like anything at all, but that's losing 10 to 20% of the total number of insects over just a decade.
And this is a problem. Why?
We need insects to eat other bad insects like mosquitoes and aphids and these things that are serious pests. Insects are enormously important in terms of ecosystem services and pollination, so our foods and food security. Once you removed all those insects, all of the food webs in nature would come to a grinding halt in 2 to 3 weeks. And there are people in New York City that will spray their apartment if they find even a housefly in there or a moth. But part of how, yeah, right. Well, that's not necessarily the way to do things.
Okay, so what's causing this insect apocalypse?
The despoiling and the degradation of habitat is the number one threat to insects, turning habitat into strip malls. And behind that, and maybe overtaking it very soon, will be climate change, driving insect diversity down in rainforests. Rainforests are really the cradle of plant and animal diversity on our planet. And we're very afraid that the droughts and the fires associated with climate change are driving sweeping changes in places we're not even measuring yet.
Everyone loves butterflies,
And I understand the monarch butterfly is particularly endangered. How come?
It's probably multiple stressors. So now we're starting to think that it's just this huge mass of agriculture and the industrialized agriculture that we have in the Midwest, where this is one of the primary breeding grounds.
Monarchs rely on milkweed and its milkweed nectar, and there's a dwindling supply.
If all of the nectar sources have been sprayed or removed or replaced with these crops that provide no pollen and no nectar, this desert of soybean and corn, it's hard for an insect to get over that.
Then there's the annual monarch migration. Every fall, millions of monarchs make the arduous 2-month journey to Mexico, where they spend the winter in a mountain forest. They can't catch a break there either.
We think we're losing monarchs at the overwintering ground because of climate fluctuation. We have logging at the overwintering sites in Mexico, and there's new diseases that are being introduced that are challenging the monarch. So right there, we just came up with at least 6 or 7 reasons, Barry, why we think we're losing monarchs. So it's death by 1,000 cut.
Insects have always gotten a bad rap. How do you bring people around?
Well, you know, that's in the United States. By the time we get to Asia, insects are much beloved. And so they're kept as pets, for example. You can buy insects to keep at home, giant beetles with horns and that sort of thing.
I just have this image of someone having a beetle on a leash, on a little leash, walking the beetle. I have to go walk the beetle, dear. I'll be back later.
Yeah, that's right. Well, there's probably somebody that actually does that.
This has been great. David Wagner, thank you so much.
Oh, you're welcome. It was fun.
March is Women's History Month, and when NASA announced the 18 astronauts listed for its Artemis lunar project, half were women. Our Donna Hanover met with astronaut Jessica Meir, one of the chosen 18, to discuss everyday living in space.
NASA astronaut Dr. Jessica Meir says daily life in space is a chance to do great work and to have some fun. Jessica served on the space station for 7 months, starting in September 2019, fulfilling a lifelong dream.
My mom tells me that I was 5 years old when I started saying I wanted to be an astronaut.
Eating in space has some aspects that would delight a 5-year-old.
You can turn your spoon upside down, or even let it go, and nothing's gonna fall off.
The astronauts exercise using a resistance machine, a treadmill, and a stationary bike. And they even have sports tournaments as much as they can.
And we're here today at the 2018 ISS Tennis Open. Congratulations on your win today, gentlemen.
For hairstyles, many astronauts go with a close cut, but others keep their locks.
How do you wash your hair up in space?
You know, I really miss my space hair. I loved this little floating conglomeration of curls that I had and kind of this little space mohawk thing I had going on. I actually made some videos while I was up there about washing my hair.
All right, now we'll scrub the shampoo, work that in. Okay, so we're on the rinse cycle to get some of that shampoo out.
For recreation, astronauts have been known to goof around, lip-syncing music videos, as Chris Cassidy did with Travis Tritt's It's a Great Day to Be Alive.
I might go get me a new tattoo. Or take my old Harley for a 3-day cruise. Might even grow me a Fu Manchu.
Some bring instruments so they can make their own music. Jessica brought her piccolo.
I also flew my panda bear, Pandemonium, who has been with me since I was 6 years old.
Many astronauts, like Jessica, credit their parents for encouraging their education and dreams. And sometimes their moms even help young people call up to the space station.
Hey, Jessica, this is Mom. And Henry at Scarborough Middle School, he wants to know what you miss the most from Earth when you're at the space station. Thank you.
Oh, well, hi, Mom. So this is where I say I miss my mom the most, yeah. I guess.
It takes an adventurous spirit to make it to space. As a biologist, Jessica had been to the Antarctic several times to study emperor penguins. She'd also done research on the barheaded goose because it migrates over the Himalayas where there's little oxygen. She even bonded with the goslings and became their mother goose. Before she went into space, her training included caving. Jessica also got her pilot's license, and her experience scuba diving was useful when she needed to train by working on a mock-up of the space station in a neutral buoyancy environment. That culminated on October 18, 2019, when Jessica with Christina Cook did the first all-female spacewalk.
You never forget what it feels like when you open that hatch, you look down below you, and as I'm coming out, I see nothing but my boots, and then the void and blackness of space, and then the earth below.
On the spacewalk, or at any time up there, did you ever feel scared?
There's definitely risk involved in our job when you're strapping yourself on a rocket or you're living in this pressurized environment in the vacuum of space. But I look at it as controlled risk. We are training for years before the mission, and especially for any kind of high-risk scenario or big emergency type events.
And now both Jessica and Christina are among the 18 initial astronauts chosen by NASA for the Artemis project, aiming for the moon and beyond. That means Jessica will very likely have more chances to feel the exhilaration of life in space.
It was just so different from anything else that we ever experience on Earth. So I find myself looking back at the pictures, looking back at the video, liking telling the stories again, just to make it all seem real again, because it truly was the happiest period of my life.
I'm Donna Hanover for Simply Science.
And that's our show. Questions, comments? You can always find us at tv.cuny.edu, Facebook, YouTube, and Instagram. I'm Barry Mitchell. Stay warm, stay safe, and we hope to see you next time on Simply Science. Ba-ba-da-dum-dum-dum.